Welcome everyone who is joining us for the second half of the first day of this conference. I'm just going to wait before I formally start. Just we can see the numbers of people logging on steadily climbing. So we'll just give people another few seconds to join us before we formally begin proceedings. So it's a good time to get water, coffee, snacks to make yourself comfortable for the second half of the conference. So I'm going to begin and welcome you all back to part two of Concerning Photography conference, a collaboration between the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art and the Photographers Gallery. My name is Sarah Turner and I'm the Deputy Director of the Paul Mellon Centre. And it's been absolutely fantastic to collaborate with the team at the Photographers Gallery on shaping this event. And if you attended this morning, I think you'll agree that events like this provide a moment of gathering and of reflection on historic practices and a chance to think about the connections between the past and the present. And we had five terrific papers. It was such a full and interesting morning and really fantastic discussion as well. So we really encourage you to be part of the conversation and the discussion as we go through this afternoon's panel. I just want to take you quickly through some of our housekeeping rules and guidelines before I hand over to our chair of this session. So the session will contain two 15-minute papers in the Pedagogies panel, and that will be followed by a Q&A session. And this will be followed by a 10-minute comfort break. And then we'll return after the break for a keynote by the artist Mahtab Hussain, and there'll be a chance to ask him questions after that. To ask questions, use the Q&A function at the bottom of your Zoom screen, and you can type your questions into that, and the chairs of the session will be able to read out your questions and put them to the speakers. The session is being recorded, so you can watch it back later and share it with all your networks, your friends, your students as well. If you want to use the closed captioning function as well, which can be really useful, you click the CC button, which is on the bottom right-hand corner of the screen to enable the captions. So thank you to our audience for joining us from all across the world. It's a real pleasure to have you with us, along with our panelists who are going to present some really fascinating insights. And I think this theme of pedagogies will really link to some of the conversations and discussions we had about infrastructure this morning. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Karen Shepherdson, who is our chair for the Pedagogies panel. Karen, over to you.
Oh, thank you so much, Sarah. And I'm thrilled to be with you today. So hello, everyone. And welcome to this afternoon's session concerning photography and specifically pedagogies. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Karen Shepherdson. I'm Programme Director of Photography at London College of Communication and a reader here too. And it's my great pleasure to be chairing this afternoon's panel and linking into what I think is a highly anticipated artist's keynote event towards the end of the day. For those of us within various institutions of education or working with graduates coming from creative practice, concerning photography, pedagogies seems highly salient, perhaps never more so. And chiming in with some of the themes of this ambitious conference, considering pedagogic histories, politics, cultural positionings, geographical and geopolitics positioning of past, presents and futures, considering the presence of the past residing in our presence. So I think we're going to have a cracking afternoon. And to kick us off, we have two speakers, which I'm going to introduce. So I'm going to introduce now, and then we'll move to our first speaker. Our first is Anne Lyden, who is Chief Curator of Photography at the National Galleries of Scotland in Edinburgh, where she's responsible for the collection of some 55,000 plus images. Prior to joining NGS, Anne was Associate Curator of Photographies at the J. Paul Getty Museum in Los Angeles, as we know. She's curated numerous exhibitions, including the work of Helen Adamson, Paul Strand and Diane Arbus. She's the author of a number of books, including Railway Visions, Photography, Travel and Perception, The Photographers of Frederick H. Evans, A Royal Passion, Photography and Queen Victoria, and very recently, A Perfect Chemistry, The Photographs of Hill and Adamson. But our first speaker of the afternoon is Dr. Juliet Hackin. Juliet is Programme Director of the MA in Contemporary Art and also Subject Lead in Photography at Sotheby's Institute of Art. She's the General Editor of Photography, The Whole Story, author of Lives of the Great Photographers, I think both of which were published by Thames and Hudson, author of Photography and the Art Market, and the co-editor of Photography and the Arts, Essays on the 19th Century Practices and Debates. Alongside that, Juliet is also co-series editor of the new Hot Topics in the Art World, something we're all looking forward to seeing. So Juliet's paper is Talking Pictures, Teaching Photography as Art in Higher Education. So Juliet, can I pass over to you now? So if you can put your screen on.
Can you hear me? I'm having struggling, of course, with my IT. Okay.
Don't worry at all. We can get you there.
But you can hear me and you can see me.
I can hear you and I can see you beautifully.
Okay. Thank you, Karen, for that kind introduction. I'm just going to see if I can get this up. Is that full screen?
That looks great.
Yes, it is.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for setting this up. It's an absolutely brilliant occasion to be discussing 50 years of photography in the UK. I am going to read this. It is a script. I'm sorry about that, but it's very new. In her 1979 essay, Lookers, Buyers, Dealers and Makers, Martha Rosler invokes a new intelligentsia of photography currently developing in university programmes. She was not speaking about academic theorists of photography such as Rosalind Krauss, then at CUNY. Instead, Rosler drew attention to the validating role of those newly enfranchised academics who would, she wrote, give a legitimacy to that reified cultural entity, the history of photography, and to specific works within it. Rosler did not specify professors, institutions, programmes or cohorts in her essay. In what follows, I will be examining some of the specifics of this particular photographic pedagogy, insisting upon its institutional character in order to draw out what was distinctive about the higher educational scene for photography in the UK in the 1970s and 80s. According to photography specialist Stuart Alexander, by 1963, the teaching of photography at university level had become such a significant force in the United States that it led to the founding of the SPE, the Society for Photographic Education, led by Nathan Lyons. Oh, hang on, I've got a problem with my slides there. Okay. Well, this speaks of a specific post-war boom in photographic education, arising in part from the 1944 GI Bill and the social and economic currency of mass media and advertising. It's important to stress that many educators had formulated their pedagogic approaches in much earlier periods. We can see this by looking at the attendees at the Invitational Teaching Conference of 1962, also organized by Lyons, which led to the founding of SPE. The 28 attendees included Harry Holmes Smith, who taught the first course in photography at the New Bauhaus in Chicago in 1937, Art Zinzerbach, who'd studied with Moholy Nagy and Harry Callahan at the same institution and become a part-time instructor there, Aaron Siskin, a tutor at the same institution from 1951, Minor White, who became in 1947 or had become in 1947, the primary instructor teaching photography as an expressive medium at the California School of Fine Arts in a department founded by Ansel Adams. Also Walter Rosenblum, who was at Brooklyn College, and Beaumont Newhall, who taught at Rochester Institute of Technology from 1956. John Sarkowski, recently appointed to MoMA, and a young Jerry Alsman, also in attendance, had studied with Newhall at RIT. Beaumont Newhood later characterised his role in achieving accredited status for the history of photography in higher education at RIT as one of the many triumphs of what was, to him, a lifelong campaign to elevate the status of photography to art. The photographic pedagogy that I'm describing is not only distinctive for its lineages, its long lineages, but also its pedagogical nexus with institutional collections, not only of photographs, but also of the book collections that these fostered or attracted. Among influential US curator educator historians such as Newhall, we can also name Frank Van Deren Koch and Peter Bunnell. Van Deren Koch was in 1962 appointed professor of art, chairman of the Department of Art and director of the Art Museum at the University of New Mexico, an institution that Newhall would join in 1971. When in 1972, photography entered an Ivy League university, Princeton, in the form of the first endowed history of photography professorship in the US, the appointee, Peter Bunnell, had also studied with Newhall at RIT. The professorship in the history of photography and modern art was endowed by one of the most influential US photophiles of the 20th century, David Hunter McAlpine III, whose mother was a Rockefeller, according to Rosler, one of the families who own high culture, and a prime mover, together with Ansel Adams and Beaumont Newhall, behind the establishment of the Department of Photography at MoMA in 1940. Bunnell was also the curator of the Princeton University Art Museum, and like Otto Steinert at the Folkwang Museum of Design, School of Design in Essen, used the collection he was building as his teaching materials. Although I should say that Steinert's collection, I think at that moment, was both personal and institutional. There was a bit of a gray area. In this way, Bunnell, who at MoMA had been responsible for shows that integrated photography within the other arts, became an apologist for photography itself, in charge of the acquisition and care of a collection whose very existence promulgated medium specificity. This institutional pedagogy tied to the object could also be exported. When the Musée d'Orsay in the late 70s wanted to train up Francois Albrun to be the museum's first curator of photography, she was sent to Princeton to take Peter Bunnell's classes on photography. Now, you've probably noticed in the account so far that I only really realized much too late in the process that very few female educators appear in this account or indeed at that conference, although they do claim to have invited two women to be there. So that's a whole other subject that's generated from this topic, which is female educators and academics in photography. Some of whom we see here, and also someone like Lisette Modell has such a pedagogic lineage which goes back to the Photo League in the 1930s. So that's a whole other area to consider. We might do in the questions, I guess. This institutionalized androcentric modernist pedagogy of whatever shading, whether socially engaged, expressive, neo-surrealist or straight, together with its institutionally published literature, forged a self-referential cohesiveness that should be seen as a defining aspect of creative photography, which, although not necessarily commonly defined in this way, should perhaps be identified as American, differentiating, I would argue, perhaps from what is a European inflected independent photography. As Rosler recognized, the codification of photographic histories and aesthetics in the classroom was also decisive in the emergence of an art market sector based on early photography in the 1970s. Now, of course, while books such as these were available to a UK audience, we can see from what I've just traced that there was no similarly entrenched institutional culture of photography as there was in the US in the early 1970s, the occasion for this conference. Other significant interplay we can say between the US, of course, there were many journals we could mention that may have been read in both countries, and also books as well in circulation, and also one such as this one on the right, Dialogue with Photography, which marks the collaboration of, the visiting lectureship program at Trent Polytechnic. So we have Paul Hill and Joshua Cooper on the front, who was one of those American visiting professors. And the book itself, intriguingly, has this, this dedication at the beginning. So Mae McWilliams, a very excellent article on photographic pedagogy in the 1970s UK has noted this significant engagement with US photographic culture. We might also point to individual connections such as Tony Ray Jones, the British graphic designer and photographer who gained a scholarship to Yale School of Art in 61 and then studied at Roderich's design lab based in Richard Avedon's studio in 62 to 63 and became a visiting lecturer in photography at the San Francisco Art Institute. And I think it's important to also stress these kind of directional thrusts which go in the opposite direction from the US to the UK, as I've been discussing. Despite these dynamic sites and instances of creative transnational exchange, it's important to stress that, as Alexandra Muscovy tells us, academic courses on photography that were offered in the UK in the 1970s were confined to colleges of art and to polytechnics and had not penetrated the universities. Although the US has its own polytechnics and technical universities, the Polytechnic, as most people here will know, has a particular history in the UK in the 1960s to 1990s. These institutions gained critical mass on the back of the Robbins Committee report of 60 to 61, which responded to the need for more education in science and technology to invigorate post-war industry, advocated the establishment of teaching rather than research institutions in higher education. According to Muscovy, in the 1970s, 15 UK polytechnics and art schools would start to offer higher education in photography. In identifying the establishment of these new polytechnics as crucial to creating new possibilities for photographic education, McWilliams notes that the Council for National Academic Awards, the central validating and funding body for the polytechnics, were able to award degrees, diplomas, and certificates of a comparable standard to those accredited by the universities. While, of course, this was a radical development, other commentators have argued that the polytechnics were established in part to preserve the distinction that a higher degree from a traditional university conferred. Indeed, the establishment of the 1960s polytechnics created a two-tier system that became known as the binary divide. When the system came to an end in 1992 with the Higher and Further Education Act, the majority of polytechnics and many art schools became new universities with their own degree awarding powers. Thus, photography decisively entered the UK university system in the 1990s, not the 70s. And it would in time become possible to study at a British university history and theory of photography divorced from practice. On that note, this is the point at which I wish to disrupt the established narrative of the narrative trajectory of the history of photographic education as that of its eventual penetration of higher education and its successful entry into the citadel of art history in the same way it was acclaimed to have entered the citadel of art in 1970s Manhattan. That narrative is a linear one, which asserts the triumph of a venerable aestheticism informed by the assumption that a shedding of techné is the criteria of photography's elevated status. It's not my intention to critique accounts of higher education photography in the UK, such as that by Ian R. Smith, which was substantively expressed as a timeline, but only to point to the teleological imperative that often underpins such analyses. In the early 1980s, two books were published that were clearly designed for the burgeoning demographic of those studying photography in English language higher education. On the left, we see the classic Essays of Photography, edited by Alan Trachtenberg in the American Studies Department at Yale in the US. And on the right, Thinking Photography, edited by Victor Bergen, then based at the School of Communication at the Polytechnic of Central London. Both were anthologies, but whereas the former made a claim for canonical status for a series of writings on photography beginning with Niepce, the latter made its claim on the present intellectual moment, with Bergen's introduction reading like a manifesto. A number of the essays, including those by Walter Benjamin, previously appeared in those journals such as Studio International, Art Forum, and Screen, that created a forum for the application of semiotic, psychoanalytic, and feminist theory to visual culture. Photography lent itself to such theorizations because it had no established university discourse. Its critical theory evolving out of analyses dating back to the 1920s of cinema and mass media rather than art history. Is elevation two, to use Rosalind Krauss's term, a theoretical object at the UK Polytechnics and Art Schools, was not an attempt at assimilation to the university system. Instead, it was part of a wider claim to cultural terrain that was largely excluded from traditional university pedagogy, such as critical theory, sociology, and media studies. At the same time, and this is important, I think, I wanted particularly in relation to the discussion this morning, it was about talking pictures. Thinking photography promoted consideration of photography as an art practice, and that's a quotation from Bergen. In so doing, it became a significant site, not for the promotion of self-referential lineages, but instead of that plurality of approaches that would in time itself reinvigorate the teaching of photography at university as university art history. In 1971, the American photography critic A.D. Coleman called for a US photography education in the spirit of Laszlo Moholy-Nagy, not aestheticism. The dominance of curatorial photographic pedagogy in US higher education programs, rooted in remarkably coherent lineages that mirrored the exclusions of photography itself, meant that photographic modernism was still in the ascendant. The UK would also import this connoisseurial model, but did so as a part of its emergent institutional culture of collecting that only achieved some form of critical mass, perhaps, in the 1990s. At the Polytechnics, where photography was a theoretical and practical rather than curatorial object, the UK gained its own new intelligentsia of photography, one that, instead of deriving their validation from the pedigree of its pedagogy, did so by aligning themselves with new critical possibilities. In our emergent discourse of the history of photographic education, with its linear narratives of triumphant assimilation, it might be assumed that the situation in the UK in the 1970s and 80s was merely a developmental time lag, a staging post on the way to university validation. In examining the nexus between the history of higher education, photographic history, aesthetics.
1 minute, Juliet.
Examining the nexus between the history of higher education, photographic history, aesthetics, and institutional culture, however, the 1970s and 80s emerges as a significant pedagogic moment in its own right. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Juliet. I'm bang on time. I'm sorry to have interrupted you right in that final moment. I do beg your pardon. That was wonderfully two time. Thank you. Can we now pass over, before we have questions, we'll bring questions in all together at the end, but can I pass over now to Anne and the paper on the Glasgow degree? Anne, are you there?
Yes. Hello, everyone.
Lovely. I can hear you beautifully. Thank you.
Great. I'll just start sharing. Okey-doke. It's a real pleasure to be here today with everybody, and thank you for the invitation. The Glasgow School of Art was the first of its kind in Europe to offer a bachelor's degree in fine art photography. I will provide an account of how this came to be by considering the national and international forces at play alongside the individuals and the contributions to formal education in Britain during the 1970s and 1980s. So in a way, sort of picking up from Juliet's paper before. This is not an exhaustive report, nor does it include all the key names and institutions, but the aim is to show how the climate and energies were conducive to such an event happening, and that in turn, it had a catalyst effect on the wider scene, an effect that we might call the Glasgow degree. The establishment of the Fine Art Photography degree at Glasgow School of Art was born out of the vision of Tony Jones, director of the school, and Bill Buchanan, head of Fine Art. Buchanan was a former student of GSA and had been art director of the Scottish Arts Council from 1961 to 1977. Jones had previously served on staff at the school before moving to the United States to work at the Texas Christian University at Fort Worth. Jones returned to Scotland in 1980 with a heightened sense of internationalism and a great deal of energy for what he termed the forward programme, essentially a shake-up of the existing departmental structures. The fine art department at the Glasgow School of Art had consisted of drawing and painting, sculpture and printmaking. Almost immediately, Jones transferred the Department of Murals and Stained Glass from the Design Department into the Fine Art Department and initiated the creation of the undergraduate Fine Art Photography degree course. Jones's forward programme also recognised the need to think of the future, not just as it pertained to the teaching within the school, but a wider remit of welfare for students and their prospects after graduation. Writing in the report for the Governors for Glasgow School of Art, he said, "The students who have graduated this year have gone out into a society stagnating in recession and unemployment and will try to establish themselves in careers and professions themselves hard hit. The students who are presently in course will find the situation even more difficult. We at Glasgow School of Art must continually examine and amend our work in the task we have of providing excellence in education while responding to a changed society. We must also collectively remonstrate with a government hostile to education, uncomprehending of our role and intent, it seems, on a determined campaign to dismantle the finest educational system in the world." Jones also outlined the obligation and indeed his intention to connect the school to the city in which it was based, embedding GSA so that Glasgow inhabitants, industries and professions would be familiar with the work of the students and the school. As much as he was rooting the art school and its teachings in Glasgow and its immediate locale, Jones also saw the need and importance for strong international links as part of the forward programme. In the academic years ranging from 1980 to 1982, there were several exchanges of GSA staff with American colleagues. No doubt his own tenure at Texas provided links and connections to capitalise on, and the appointment of Thomas Joshua Cooper from California as the leader of the Photography Fine Art degree course would have been entirely in keeping with this outlook, but I'll come to that later. Although it was Jones as director who launched the forward programme and had the guts to call out Thatcher's government at the time, a lot of the vision for the GSA photography degree lay with Bill Buchanan. Buchanan, a former student at Glasgow School of Art, returned in 1977, first as head of fine art, later as deputy head, and then acting head of the school itself. If Jones brought an international outlook, Buchanan offered an acute awareness of the particularities of the Scottish scene, having worked at the Scottish Arts Council for 16 years. He was also the best advocate for introducing fine art photography at the school. He was passionate about the medium, had mounted a 1970 exhibition on Hill and Adamson, and was an international authority on the work of James Craig Annan. And he would later take up the chair of Still's Gallery in Edinburgh. The founding post was awarded to Thomas Joshua Cooper, an American photographer who studied with Beaumont Newhall at the University of New Mexico, and who counted among his referees for the Glasgow job, Ansel Adams. However, it would be misleading to present Cooper as an American swooping in to radically alter the teaching of fine art photography in Scotland, indeed Britain. The reality was that he had already helped to shape and been shaped by the photography scene in Britain in the 1970s, and was as much a part of that as he was reflecting specific American values. From 1973 to 1976, Cooper worked at Trent Polytechnic in Nottingham as the course director for photographic studies and a senior lecturer in photography and the history of photography, while also conducting annual workshops at Sheffield Polytechnic. While teaching at Trent, Cooper befriended fellow instructors Paul Hill and Raymond Moore, who, like him, were photographers who championed a black and white aesthetic and aligned with a fine art tradition. This shared philosophy both reflected and contributed to changing attitudes towards photography in Britain at that time. While both Hill and Cooper had published their concerns in the September 1974 issue of Creative Camera, describing the state of photography teaching in Britain as a photographic dark age, they believed that central to their teachings at Trent Poly was the primacy of the image rather than theory or purely commercial applications. Their teaching was student-centred, encouraging self-reflection. Citing Beaumont Newhall's history of photography that had only come out the decade before, Hill and Cooper saw photography as having four major concerns: the straight, the formalistic, the documentary, and the equivalent. It was essential in their eyes that both teachers and students have, quote, a passion for photography and an obsessive desire to realise their personal truths. The same year the Creative Camera piece was published, Cooper held his first exhibition at the Photographer's Gallery in London, which Sue Davies had recently established as the first public gallery in the country dedicated to the medium of photography. When the Hayward Gallery presented three perspectives on photography in the summer of 1979, the large exhibition focused on socialism, feminism, and modernism, with each section selected by a different curator. And for those of you that were with us this morning, we heard a really great paper on the exhibition by David Bate. Paul Hill was one of the curators, and he included several of Cooper's prints alongside those by other photographers who were relatively unknown at the time, such as Martin Parr. Throughout the 1970s, Cooper and Hill collaborated, even though they were no longer teaching alongside one another at Nottingham. Together with the Magnum photographer, David Hearn, the three men produced a programme on Paul Strand, one of several that the BBC were televising about photography. Hearn had established his documentary photography course at Newport in Wales in 1973, which was set out originally as a 12-month training skills course and later morphed into a degree course. Higher education for photography was beginning the shift away from the vocational and diploma status towards serious study and ultimately degree bearing. A staple on every assigned reading list on photography courses was the 1979 book Dialogue with Photography, authored by both Hill and Cooper. It featured detailed interviews with 22 photographers, and to this day it has never been out of print. Cooper was thus very much part of the distinctly British scene around photography in the 1970s, and was actively advocating for photography as fine art through his own practice, his teachings, and his creative outputs in television and publishing. Although he left the UK in 1979 to return to his native California, he had already left a legacy behind. It was not a surprise then that he should feature as a prime candidate for the job at Glasgow. Indeed, it is telling that of the four candidates selected, three mentioned Cooper by name in their own interviews. When Cooper arrived back in the UK in 1982 to take up the post in the newly created department at GSA, he discovered that no actual photography department existed. He would be creating it from the ground up with classes beginning the following academic year. At the time, Glasgow and other Scottish schools offered technical classes, but few institutions allowed photography courses to count towards a fine art degree, a critical distinction. The pressure was then on to get the degree ready for the incoming class, and required legislative changes and approval from both the Scottish Education Department and the British degree awarding body, the Council for National Academic Awards. Cooper was faced with the task of creating the course structure to the satisfaction of these political agencies, while also ensuring that the programme would be very much embedded within the Fine Art Department. The Glasgow School of Art was the first of its kind in Europe to offer a bachelor's degree in fine art photography. While the Kunstakademie Düsseldorf in Germany had appointed Bernd Bescher, Professor of Fine Art Photography in 1976, the degree awarded to his students was in fine art, not fine art photography. The community that built up around the programme in Glasgow was tight-knit in the beginning, with about a dozen students, including Jean Beard, Peter Finnemore, David Hazel, and Richard Learoyd. There were lots of outcomes from the introduction of the degree. Jean Baird, one of the first students to enrol in the course, later received the distinction of being awarded a Fulbright scholarship, the first time it had been awarded in the UK for photography. Martha McCulloch was the first postgraduate student and went on to be the first director of street level gallery in the city in 1989, working alongside Katrina Grant, another graduate of the Fine Art Photography degree in Glasgow. Richard Learoyd graduated in 1988 and embarked on a hugely successful international career. Cooper taught independent critical thought and demanded that his students think analytically about photography. According to Learoyd, Cooper was concerned about, quote, facilitating the individual. It was never a formal imprint of his style, end quote. This aligns with Cooper and Hill's earlier position of always being student-centered. With more than 700 students having studied photography over the course of Cooper's tenure, the impact of the degree is widespread and global. Graduates went on to teach at courses and universities around the world, advocating their own approach, but ultimately championing fine art photography and the importance of the history of photography. But the Glasgow degree also had much more immediate effect locally at the time. The formalising of the degree within higher education was a validation not only of the academic kind, but an indication of an enthusiasm for photography in all its guises. In the days and months leading up to the course launching, Bill Buchanan was also spearheading plans to form the Scottish Society for the History of Photography, commonly referred to as SHOP. The Society's key objective was, and still is, to further interest, understanding and pleasure in both historic and contemporary photography, to expand local Scottish photography and bring international talent into this community. Buchanan held the inaugural meeting in his office at the McIntosh Building after a hugely successful international conference also organised by him. And I'm showing this slide again because right above the entrance to the McIntosh Building is the director's office, and that's where SHOP was born. Entitled Scottish Contributions to Photography, the three-day event took place in Glasgow in March 1983. The conference attracted three times its expected audience, drawn perhaps by the roster of national and international photo historians. Things were also happening elsewhere in Scotland. From the 1970s onwards, efforts to showcase photography had been building and were most visible in the creation of Stills Gallery Edinburgh in 1977, emerging from the Scottish Photography Group, set up by Richard Hoff, Michael Edwards, and David Pashley. The following year, Corridor Gallery was established in Glenrothes by Asa Goldsmith and her husband, Peter, and was an incredible resource for showcasing the work of emerging photographers at the time. A 1979 working group had been formed to investigate the feasibility of a national collection of photography involving several national bodies, and ultimately led to the creation of the Scottish National Photography Collection at the National Galleries of Scotland. While photography had featured at NGS since the early 20th century, it was now formally recognised in 1984 as a distinct collection based on the huge efforts and scholarship of Sarah Stevenson and before her, Catherine Michelson, both of whom had worked extensively on the extensive Hill and Adamson material that is the cornerstone of the photographic collection. As to be expected, the overlapping connections of those interested in the medium were many, whether for its practical application, art historical research, or pure pleasure. The Glasgow degree set off a series of reactions with other Scottish art schools and places of higher education, phasing in degree-bearing courses in photography. Gradually, the ripples within the photographic community widened in Scotland, spreading further and encompassing more. Such was the feeling that photography was now being recognised as an art form and essentially becoming quote unquote mainstream, that the Scottish Arts Council decided to subsume their specialist photography committee into the visual arts. There was momentum in all areas, from governmental bodies, higher education, national institutions, and a growing number of societies, associations, and clubs. This is not to say that the Glasgow degree was the sole catalyst, but it was activating and contributing to the photography landscape of Scotland and beyond. The Scottish Society for the History of Photography, set up within the walls of GSA by Buchanan, became a nexus, counting Cooper, Stevenson, and many others within its founding ranks, including Murray Johnston, who in 1986 was appointed head of photography at Edinburgh College of Art and was responsible for introducing the degree course there. Murray, along with his wife, Kate Johnston, also established Scottish Photographic Works, a company whose aim was to publicise, support and market the best of independent photography in Scotland. By 1988, Gloria Chalmers had established Portfolio Gallery in the Scottish capital, followed by the magazine, which ran until 2010, both championing photography as fine art. Meanwhile, Pashley, who had helped form Stills Gallery, became a central figure in the establishment and development of photography at Edinburgh Napier, helping to steer the course from HND to CNNA degree and ultimately to honours degree later in the 1990s. It took a little longer for the teaching of the history of photography to become part of the honours curricula within art history departments at Scottish universities. The University of Glasgow appears to have started in the first half of the 1990s, and the University of St Andrews followed in the second half of the decade. As with most subjects, attempting to chart a history is not necessarily linear. Instead, it can form a series of overlapping moments, critical masses, and a network of dependencies and connections. Such is the case with the Glasgow degree, deliberately named for this paper and intended as a play on words. It is, of course, a nod to the 6 degrees of separation theory, which posits that anyone can be connected to anyone else in the world through 6 or less connections. Now, you can see from my slide, I'm not skilled enough to be able to adequately demonstrate this. This took quite some working on just with what I had. But as I hope my slide shows, it paints a picture suggesting these interlocking connections and dependencies concerning the introduction of fine art photography at Glasgow School of Art.
1 minute, Anne.
It's not exhaustive, indeed. If anything, I think I've only scratched the surface, and much more research is required, which again has been a theme that's come through the papers this morning as well. The ecosystem that is photography involves many different people, places, institutions, galleries, collections, journals, and so on. It is exponential, and we are all connected. As we gather here to celebrate the Photographers' Gallery, it is worth reminding ourselves that no one can do this alone. It takes us all working together to champion, support, interrogate, challenge, and ultimately be concerned about photography. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much, Anne and Juliet, for two utterly fascinating and gripping talks. I completely lost track of time myself, and luckily I had a beeper on. So thank you so much. I know that we have some Q&As, so you can start to be adding those Q&As, and I'll turn to those in a moment. But perhaps I can just sort of kick off while we've got some minutes to think about that. And of course, I think what Juliet would not be surprised to hear, my first impression was, or my first observation was, men, men, men. Perhaps unsurprising given sort of the historical context. But also, Anne, your quote by Tony Jones around the concern for the prospects of those Glasgow graduates, which in so many ways just feels too contemporaneous. You know, these are concerns that we still share today. But I think I'm quite curious, and it might come through some of the Q&A as well, but I'm curious to hear more from both of you in terms of the photographic educations that you so beautifully outlined, as to their sort of hermetically sealed natures. Juliet, the slide that you showed of, for example, Newhall's publication, The History of Photography, you know, in one sense, the history, not histories, of photography as a single being. And are the visions and values that we see underpinning photographic education, whilst importantly opening up photography as a subject for us to study, nevertheless risks potentially remaining reductive?
Just to say something about the history of photography, I know exactly what you're saying, and it does seem such a, Newhall's text seems such an incredible text. It was first, I'm now going to forget blank the date, but it was first published in the 40s, and then went into three or four publishings, the last one in 1982, and it was certainly on the shelves when I went to college and wanted to study the history of photography. At the same time, as we've all been talking about, it's not as monolithic if it seems. It's really interesting to look at the evolutions in his own thinking within that. We like to use these as kind of examples of a kind of hermetically sealed culture, etc., and of course they were very powerful, but it means sometimes we avoid looking at what's going on. For instance, Newhall, you know, doesn't really talk about photography as an art form to the second edition, and then it's buried in like chapter two. He sort of, you know, says actually all photography is sort of expressive and an art form, but it's literally buried. And as it goes on over the 20th century, it becomes more overt that it's an expressive medium for him, which is an evolution about what he probably felt he could say.
Mm. Thank you, Juliet. And did you want to come on in?
Yeah, I think it's important to also just put it into context that there's, for even though it was defined as the history and not sort of taking in the plurality that we've been discussing today in part, I think it was also an attempt for the first time to kind of begin that documenting that history, like creating that canon and starting. Now, obviously, in doing that, there was lots of people that were omitted, but it was also a starting point. And it has been very sort of foundational for the teaching of photography in schools and universities all over the world. So it has a huge impact, but also I think it I'd like to see it as the first crack at it, if you like, and that we, you know, we, that the story is still ongoing, the histories are still being made, and it is up to us, mm-hmm. Whether we're, you know, academics, curators, photographers, researchers, you know, to be showcasing, highlighting, sharing those stories, you know. So I don't see it as so static and closed. Yes. I think the responsibility does pass to us all.
Thank you so much for that. Yeah, and I was very struck as you moved towards completion or conclusion, Anne, about that notion of that interconnectedness of the ancestors, the interconnectedness and the incompleteness that we're moving forward all the time, and we have some agency in that. I can see some questions are coming in, and I do want to be able to use this time for those. So I can see one from Towers, and I'll read it out. Thank you for your fascinating papers. I'm very interested in the transatlantic dialogues as constant presence in both your papers. I was wondering if you could tell us more about other aspects of this North American influence in the institutionalization of British photography. Thank you very much.
It's what I hoped in that my slide, while I was focusing more on Glasgow, you could see there was already a lot of those North American connections that were sort of showing up. And indeed, I was sort of looking at it from a moment sort of immediately before and then after. But if you go further back, you've got people like, you know, Bill Jay, who makes the move over and is then teaching at the University of New Mexico as well. And he had been such an influence within British photography, both prior to his departure, but then even after he had left too, he continued to be a force as well. So I think it is definitely something that was happening and continues, you know, to happen. And probably because of the shared language, the English language, again, it's like back to what we were just talking about with Newhall's, book being published. We can't underestimate how much that sort of defines our knowledge just by simply being accessible in a language that is available to us. Mm. I think that accounts for a lot of those interactions across the Atlantic, if you like. It's because of that sort of, first and foremost, a shared language and a sort of certain shared sensibility that then comes about with that.
Thank you, Anne. Juliet,
Karen, you go.
No, I'll pass to you.
Okay. No, I was actually going to say that I think probably that's something that I would ask others to kind of, you know, contribute to look at that. And I was fascinated by that element of what I was talking about. But I just wanted to perhaps say, look, let's not forget Europe, you know, just because that my paper in particular focused on that. And Annie's to less a little bit. Less so, but and I think it's really important that it is a language thing, but at the same time, I mean, there's lots of connections. I mean, you know, the people who were involved in that project, the Paul Hill and Thomas Joshua Cooper one, you know, they had these fantastic letters of reference from Beaumont Newhall, but also from Latigue as well. And so there is a lot going on, and I'm just really kind of putting in a plea to say, let's not forget what's happening in Europe. Especially with the founding of Arles in, I think, 1971, etc. But I do think probably still there, possibly based on that wonderful exhibition they did in Paris a few years ago, the 70s, the American 70s, that in both Europe and the UK often looked to the US in the 70s. It felt that things were more evolved and dynamic, whether that's right or wrong. So it's a very kind of interesting kind of geographical exchanges going on with everyone working together, but also looking to the States, I think.
Thank you for that, Juliet. We've got a question coming in from an anonymous attendee. Ooh, always a bit of a risk, but here we go. Juliet referenced the different philosophies behind American pedagogy, which was informed very much by the modernist canon and that taught in Europe and the UK. Can you describe a little further what those very different approaches amounted to in the 1970s, and then how they impacted on the photography produced here in the UK?
Okay, gosh, that is a big question. So I think that, I mean, it's tricky because again, it's very, in such a short presentation, it's very easy to present things as very straightforward and easy, and you know, and this looked like this, you know, Ulsman looks like Sarkowski and things like that. And of course the work was very different, but you know, there does seem to be the sense of two, you know, there's a pantheistic, what I call pantheistic modernism that comes out of the States, which I associate with Ansel Adams. In particular, kind of really about nature, about landscape, about one's feelings in the landscape, to that, a kind of romantic entanglement with the landscape. And then, of course, there's a kind of, as we saw in the slides that I showed, a very much a kind of Moholy-Nagy derived Bauhaus type of photography, light experimentation at homes. I want to say that there was colour photography as well, but I couldn't get colour images to download for this. So it all looks very cohesive and black and white. So there's that, and also there's this kind of much more, you know, the sort of strand formalism. And of course, that kind of what I was calling a neo-surrealist, again, that sort of tying into that kind of meat yard, Van Deren coat, we saw the double exposures. So those are kind of, those are the kind of different main strands, I guess, in socially engaged photography, as we saw with Walter Rosenblum. I mean, I think one of the interesting things about all of this is how people came to define these as all kind of a piece. You know, they seem so incredibly different to me, but they were kind of, you know, imported as having a common sensibility as such. Now, as for how that particularly was absorbed into the teaching and students' practice, that I'm not there yet. So great question, but I hope to do some more work on that. Maybe others here can comment on that.
Yes, I think there's still much work to be done, and that's always an exciting point in terms of our own histories and theories and our own reflections. We're moving towards the break, and I think that it's always good to have some comfort breaks and a moment of a caffeine recharge before the next set, as it were. But I just wanted to say that we've had a message coming from Martin. That's Martin Pover, just saying, you know, let's not forget another significant player in photography education who didn't emanate from the USA. And I think that we're all much of a muchness about that, about the complexity of that. But referencing, for example, Evans, who started documentary photography at the Guildford School, which was, I think, in the late 1950s. And of course, Jane Bowne, amongst many others, would emerge from that particular school. So yeah, fair point, Martin. Yeah, thank you.
I just say my paper was a preamble to, you know what I mean, a preamble to then what comes next. And I absolutely want to say that's a springing off point for then thinking about the UK situation as being really dynamic.
I think, Juliet, for me, some of the most enjoyable and shifting conferences are just that moment where we are able to be thinking this is actually a springboard into something more and developing. And I think that that's perhaps the very best that we can be wanting from our conferences. So we're going to have a break now. We're going to reconvene, I think, let me just check on my notes. I think it's 3:20 and I'm known as the police of time. So if we can come back at 3:20, yes, you can see that I'm ringing here to say that it's time for our break. So if you can come back at 3:20, and where we'll have the much anticipated keynote from Mahtab Hussain. Thank you so much. And can I thank once more Anne and Juliet for two really provoking papers. I thoroughly enjoyed our time together. So thank you. Hello everyone, we should be back now. I think it's 3:20, and just looking at people coming in, I can see that most of us are here. Welcome back. It's my pleasure to welcome back and present and introduce Mahtab Hussain. I think there's times when we say little introduction is required, but I would just like to contextualize Mahtab's practice, because I think it is so significant of this particular moment and of times to come. British artist Mahtab Hussain explores the significant relationships between identity, heritage, and displacement. His themes develop through long-term research, articulating a visual language that challenges the prevailing concepts of multiculturalism. Given the framework of this afternoon's sessions, I'm really interested in seeing that Mahtab has received his first degree, his BA, in History of Art at Goldsmiths, specializing in post-colonialism and photography, and then an MA in Museum and Gallery Management at City here in London, and then a subsequent MA in Photography at Nottingham Trent University. Mahtab's You Get Me series focuses on young working class Asian men in contemporary Britain. The exhibition was curated by Mark Seeley and launched at Autograph in 2017, before traveling on to Impressions Gallery in Bradford and then beyond. His Going Back Home to Where I Come From, Made in Kashmir and Pakistan, explored ideas around homeland, loss, memory, and the overview effect, which was exhibited at New Art Gallery in Warsaw. And his Honest With You series is about femininity, sisterhood, resistance, and political defiance of British Muslim women. Mahtab has been the recipient of numerous awards and commissions. He was also winner of the Curator's Choice Award and was selected as the 2015 Lightwork and Autograph ABP Artist in Residence. Mahtab was also chosen from, I think, over 500 international artists to be the discovery artist under the prestigious Discoveries Award in 2016 at the Houston Photo Fest. Mahtab presents a keenly anticipated talk around his practice and research, discussing really urgent and important themes of immigration, representation, selfhood, and the power of the gaze through portraiture. Considering why community collaborations are important to respond to the poor visibility and stereotyping of Muslim communities globally, and how through the power of the gallery wall, a different conversation or conversations can take place that not only challenge across all the spectrums, but uplifts and enriches the understanding of a community that has felt silent and, to quote Mahtab, muzzled. That's powerful stuff, powerful terms. Mahtab has the potency to shift not just photography, but the ways in which we view the world. So without further ado, I'm going to pass over to you, Mahtab. And then as we finish that presentation, Mahtab, Louise is going to pick it up for Q&A. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's quite an introduction. Thank you. Okay, so I'm just going to share my screen so I can then start my talk. Let's make sure everyone can see this. Can everyone see this okay?
That looks great. If you just want to go through the screen, brilliant.
Perfect. Thank you. Okay, so I'm just going to, step in really. So, I mean, that was a great introduction, and I guess I don't really have to say much else, but yeah, my background was in museum and galleries, and you know, I really had a career in museums for about 8 years, and I didn't really think I was going to be an artist. I wanted to find those artists that were making work about the British Muslim experience, but you know, being looking and researching the work that was out there, it felt like it was some of the work was very ghettoizing, and it really wasn't reflecting my experiences. So while I was working at the National Portrait Gallery, I ended up going back home to Birmingham most weekends and holidays to start this body of work. And it was really for me and for about 4 years I actually didn't really show the work to anyone, this was the kind of work I started to make, and this was really the start of my You Get Me series. And at the time I was literally helping all sorts of people, whether it was men, women, looking at material details. But you know, I was really interested in street culture. I was really interested in how these young men were defining themselves under this political pressure of being labeled everything that they're labeled, you know, whether they're a terrorist or a threat to society or they don't belong. And you know, I really felt and I knew the power of museum and gallery walls. And so I used to say to these young men when I came across them, look, I have the opportunity to put you on in a museum. I have an opportunity to exhibit you in galleries. I mean, I was kind of fibbing at the time because, you know, I was just starting my career really. But I wanted to kind of position this work within that framework. And so this is the work that I started to make. And it was really me mapping out my own identity politics. So looking at, you know, my Pakistani identity, the fact that every year we used to celebrate the independence of Pakistan in the community and within my family. And, you know, having these dual identities that at times were quite conflicting. And, you know, over that period, you know, you had, you know, David Beckham with his cornrows, and it was interesting how, you know, that was filtering into youth culture as well. But also this idea that when I was at Goldsmiths, I really fell in love with a module called post-colonialism. And it was there that David DeBosa introduced me to some incredible artists, essentially black artists, people like Ian Kishinabari, Kerio Memes, Hank Willis Thomas, Sonia Boyce, and, you know, cultural theorists like Stuart Horn and Edward Said and Frank Fanon. And, you know, I ended up looking at the black experience within the art historical canon to really find my voice. And in a way, the South Asian male was looking at the black experience within popular culture to find their sense of representation too. So it was interesting how I went to another space, and the community that I lived with and hung around with growing up in, you know, in Birmingham and colleges were really aspiring towards the black community. And it was because there was some amazing figures. You know, there was Muhammad Ali who converted to Islam. There was Malcolm X and the Nation of Islam movement. And, you know, I think because those types of figures ended up taking on the Muslim identity, South Asian men, Muslim men really felt like they could also own a type of black experience. And so, you know, over the 4 years, I was kind of networking, walking the streets, but I also ended up wandering into a lot of these gyms and met Sal. And this is Sal. They call him Big Sal. He owns a gym in Birmingham called Flex. And Sal has this incredible urban legend about him. And I really wanted to get to know this man. So for about 3 years, I didn't even ask to have his portrait. I just wanted to know who this man was and is, given his reputation in Birmingham. And we talked about everything. You know, we talked about, you know, the difficulty growing up in Britain, how there is this kind of real sense of violence and gang culture, how, you know, there is a real sense of repression, and the fact that the Asian male really has to feel like they have to hold themselves in a very aggressive way because of the political pressure that they have faced since the 60s. And, you know, I'm talking about things like paki bashing and you know, where vans of, you know, white working class men would go around finding young Asian men to essentially be up on the streets. And so I think over that kind of violence, the South Asian man had to take a stance. I mean, my dad talked about these things, having to have fights on the streets, and my grandfather used to talk about, you know, racism within the workforce. And so, you know, I met Sal, and, you know, it made sense to me why he ended up holding himself in this way. And, you know, he came in one day with this t-shirt on, and I just loved it. And I said, I would really love to be able to make your portrait with this t-shirt. So he, you know, we met another day, he came to the gym, and we kind of sat and made this portrait together. And I think this was one of the first times that I really started to understand really playing, how I can play with powers and visual culture that's kind of demonized us. And for me, this portrait is really about feeding the beast. You know, this idea that we're always seen as threats and violence. And I was like, well, okay, let's make an image that would, you know, would articulate that, and the media would want to kind of run with. So it was this kind of tongue-in-cheek moment, but also just wanting to talk about the real complexities of our communities. And so, yeah, over the course, I started making these types of portraits. A lot of them are 3/4 length. There's a fashion element to the work. And I wanted to really celebrate that because, you know, we've been so invisible in so many parts of Western culture, and one is in the kind of fashion world. And I wanted to find beautiful brown men who I felt like were worthy enough, not just the Grace Gallery walls, but would be envied and would be celebrated. And this is kind of the exploration into the 4 years that I was making the work. And I realized that, you know, I was making work about men. So the focus ended up kind of being about men. And I wanted to question, well, what does it really mean to be a man in this community? So that was kind of my decision within the first year or so of making the work. And so I carried on building and then 4 years later into building my work, and, you know, 3 years in, I ended up leaving the National Portrait Gallery, really dedicating myself into Birmingham. I was given a wonderful opportunity to have a show at MAC in Birmingham. And it was really a project-based exhibition, and Craig Ashley and Trevor Pitt helped curate and produce the work. So we went through my archive, and this is basically what we ended up presenting. And we decided, and, you know, through my research, that I really wanted to kind of talk about the identity formations that are taking place within the community. So these are the 3 portraits. The first one is really looking at the notion of a collective identity, whether that's through your religion or through your family. And then the middle portrait is really looking at social identity. What are the identities that you start to form on the streets, away from family and away from the safety of school? And then the third identity formation is really about ego identity. How are these young men looking at the older men and the older guys, the cool guys, and kind of how are they wanting to emulate themselves in the future? So this is kind of the complexities that I felt myself growing up feeling, but also what was going on in the community. And one of the things we ended up doing, which really made me realize the power of community engagement, was I ended up transcribing the question, what does it mean to be a Pakistani male today in Urdu? And there was a wall on the side, and I allowed people to come and comment. And I think over the course of the exhibition, which was really a kind of project-based display, we ended up having, I think, about 400 post-it notes. And I, you know, kept that for research, and it really helped inform my practice. And it was the start of, you know, me really starting to kind of exhibit my work and sharing it. But as you can see straight away, there was a real element to kind of frame the work beautifully and position them quite large scale to kind of emulate contemporary portraiture. So it was basically an arts camp which allowed me 6 days myself in Birmingham. And this was the work that I started to make, looking at young men in their environments, you know, really finding beautiful men. That was really important for me. So it was really important that when these young men would be graced in gallery walls, that you end up falling in love with them. And I think it's a really important thing to do, because it allows you to kind of open yourself up. And then I felt like through that, I could have a deeper conversation and really talk about the politics and, you know, question, well, who are these men that you see? Are they threatening? Can you see them as beautiful brown men? Can you see them as fine art portraiture beyond the narrative of reportage and beyond the narrative? Interesting was that, you know, I didn't realize at the time, I always knew that my work was paying homage to 16th century court paintings, you know, paintings that I fell in love with at the National Portrait Gallery. But I was also really, also loved the kind of, you know, the side profile portrait. And only, you know, very recently, I guess, I realized that I was kind of paying homage to Mogul miniature paintings. And I think that was a very unconscious thing. And yeah, in the series, this is probably one of the only few kind of reportage type portraits. But I really wanted to include this one in the series because it really talked about this idea of, you know, how, you know, you see these two men and one's wearing Western clothes, the other one is wearing a shalwar kameez and also, you know, Adidas trainers. And, you know, they're both eating fish and chips with curry sauce. And it was like, well, it's look at this incredible mix of cultures and fashion and style and food. And I was really trying to ask the question, you know, can Islam and Western culture fit as well as this? So it was really important that this particular image made the series. And so while I was, had the show at the MAC in Birmingham, I was asked to submit a portrait at New Art Exchange for the Culture Cloud, where I won the Curator's Choice Award. And I really felt this particular portrait embodied everything that I was talking about in terms of hybridity. So you've got this young man, you know, he's wearing a Jamaican vest, he's got his muscles, which references Bollywood. You know, he's got his Islamic beard, his French crop hair, he's got the gang related tattoos on his face, and he's wearing this darviz, an amulet, which would have some form of Arabic Islamic scripture. And it was just amazing how this one image really brought everything together. And I was always talking about this idea of, you know, we're constantly split growing up. You know, you're either British or you're Muslim, you're Pakistani or you're Bangladeshi. And through my research, I wanted to say, look, we have the power to be hybrids and we should really celebrate all our complexities and bring them together. And so this was the portrait that I entered, and, you know, thankfully and really honored to have won the Curator's Choice Award, which gave me an opportunity to have my first major main gallery show at New Art Exchange. And it was curated by Melanie and Skinder wonderfully pushed for me to have the main gallery. And Skinder was director of New Art Exchange and now is the director of the British Council. And the residency was in 2014. And it was a 6-month residency where I based myself in Hyson Green, which is where New Art Exchange is. And at that point and that time, the name Nigel Farage was all over the press. And it was, he just started his name out. And the conversations that he was saying were incredibly shocking to me. These were conversations that I was having on the streets when I was growing up, this idea of, you know, migrants taking over, that we should go back to where we came from, that we're a threat, that we're vermin, that we're not worthy to be in this country. And I was, you know, I was really scared. I was thinking, wow, I didn't really think that at 27, 28, I've just had my first child. She's, you know, 1.5. And we're having the same conversation that my granddad had, my father had, and now I'm having. So I said to Skinder and Mel that I really want to look at the migrant experience in Hyson Green and really start to open up, you know, the reasons why these communities come to England. And it's the same story of my family, which was they left Pakistan, they left Kashmir to better their lives and to better our lives. You know, for the hope of education, the faith of education. And both my parents work incredibly hard, just like the communities in Hyson Green. And, you know, the main image of Ali that I used really helped steer the conversation in the space. Because when I met Ali, he talked about the horrific violence that his and his family suffered in Sudan and how they were lived in camps and being fed by organizations like Save the Children. And he came to Nottingham to study architecture, to be able to one day go back and rebuild his country. And, you know, these were the stories that I came across in Hyson Green. And so we exhibited a series called The Commonality of Strangers. And I just wanted to quickly show you this particular portrait of Hussain, Mahmud and Numan. I ended up reconnecting with Mahmud in the middle, literally last week. He found me on Instagram when I posted one of my photographs and portraits. And, you know, we were messaging, and, you know, the first thing he wrote was, "No one ever wants to take pictures of people who look like me and you." And I found that such a powerful message that I wanted to kind of share this with you all today. And we, when we spoke on the phone, he said, you know, how instrumental it was for him to see himself in a space like that, and how he carried that portrait with him for years in his room. And it kind of really steered him on to do some great things. And he ended up graduating at LSC a couple of years ago. And you know, this, you know, the art, photography and art is so powerful. I think we sometimes forget just what it can really do. And again, Mahmud said, you know, even though photography is silent, your work gives us a voice. And I really feel that with my practice. It's so important for me that the people that who trust in me to make their portrait, that I really try and represent them honestly. And it's why, you know, in the show in Common Anti Strangers, that we had text. And it was their voices and it was their stories. And the way I ended up exhibiting the work was very similar to the way the National Portrait Gallery puts on their exhibitions. And so I really wanted to kind of elevate it. And so while I was, you know, working in Birmingham, I had an opportunity to do an MA. And my MA I wanted to focus on Muslim women. And I already started to make that work, but I wanted to keep the conversation very separate from the men, because I felt like the men were having a very different conversation than the women. And what's interesting is that under this political pressure of being labelled what they're labelled, or labelled what I'm labelled, you know, whether I'm a terrorist or a terrorist sympathizer or a paedophile, or I might kill my sisters in the name of honour, these holding themselves incredibly masculine, and they're showing their sexuality as a way of saying we're proud of who we are. And it's interesting that in contrast, Muslim women have decided to reveal or veil, wear the hijab, and to cover their sexuality. And by them wearing the veil, it also identifies them as Muslim women. So it's them also saying we're proud, we're Muslim, and we want to identify. And so this was the kind of series that I started to build. It's not published yet. I'm hoping to publish it in the next year or so. But I was looking at the veil, and it was really interesting that when I went to college, 90% of the women didn't wear the veil. But through this pressure of misinformation, through being told that you were not good enough, and just our religion and our culture being demonized, a lot of the Muslim women have started to wear it as a form of defiance and to really be proud. And we know through the media and the press that the veil does bring unwanted attention and violence. Any stories of Muslim women being attacked on the streets purely because of their choice of a fabric. And, you know, it becomes very political. But also, you know, there are women who don't wear it. And I wanted to kind of make sure that I included that in the series. And what's really fascinating is that the women are streets ahead of the men. They're so much more articulate. They're really aware of their kind of the politics around them. And they're also really willing to have a different conversation and actually really step up. Because I think they've been at the front end of it more than the men, actually. So this is the series I'm building, and one of the last portraits I've made so far is of Farah. And I really wanted to get Farah to hold the cricket bat, which was referencing colonialism and the idea that Britain was colonizing countries. They also brought the game cricket to basically, civilize the savages, essentially. And so I wanted Farah to kind of try and, you know, break that mold. And she looks amazing and really fierce and confident and really breaking the stereotypes. So this is kind of the series that is building at the moment. And also while all this was happening in Birmingham, I ended up connecting with Multistory, with Emma. And Emma was really interested in my practice and and she said, I'd really love you to work in the Black Country. And she invited me to wander around Tipton, a really quiet town in just outside of Birmingham, actually. And I ended up going to Tipton, just wandering the streets, and it was an incredibly quiet space. And I really didn't know what I was going to do, because I tend to walk on the streets and find people hanging around. But a week later, when I went, after I went, there was an actual nail bomb attack that happened in one of the mosques. And it was an Eastern European chap who basically planted 3 nail bombs. And one of them actually exploded, and it happened in 2013. And when that happened, it really reinforced this idea that we don't belong. It forced this idea that one day we might be kicked out. And it also, and because these were the conversations that were taking place in my home. My dad always used to talk about, you know, we can't stay here forever. They will kick us out one day. And there will be this global war against Muslims. And this was kind of happening. And if you look at what's happening right now with our politics, you know, our civil rights are being changed. You know, that there is this real threat now that we could essentially be told to leave. And this was the conversation that was not happening just only at home, but it was also happening on the streets with the young men and women I was kind of talking to. So I said to him, I really want to connect with the community. And this is Mushtaq, who was the chairman at the time. And I met Mushtaq at home kind of afternoon. He was a bit busy and he told me to come back the next day. And we had this conversation for about 4 hours about my life, where I'm from, where my family's from, how many brothers and sisters, he wanted to know everything. And I, you know, gave him everything. And he's like, what do you want to do? And I said, I really want to get to know the people who built the mosque. I'd love to know how this community established themselves here and the impact of this particular incident. He said, okay, I'll do that for you. So every now and then I'd get a phone call from Mushtaq and he'd say, Haji Saab, Gurram, number 87, would love to meet you. Can you come around at 2 o'clock? So I jump in my car and drive, 1 or 2 hours, because I was kind of in London at the time as well. And I would knock on the door and I would be greeted by someone like this man. And this is Gurram. And he, you know, came to England when he was in the early 20s, and he's my life in the foundries, in the factories, building mattresses, boiler parts, and these most beautiful conversations with these men. And I asked them, you know, do you feel British? And they say, yeah, of course. This country has given me everything. It's given me a home. It's given me a life. I've been able to bring up my families. I've been able to educate my children. I love this country. And we would talk about the politics and I'd say, well, what do you think, what's going on? And, you know, I conversed with them in Urdu. So my mom refused to speak to me in English growing up. And I, at the time, I used to hate it. And my mom always said to me, oh, you know, you're gonna thank me one day. And as I was making this series, I was like, wow, my mom was really right. I didn't realize this was gonna be so important. And, you know, they said really poetically that, you know, they're all lies. You know, that doesn't relate to us. And it just really broke my heart that, you know, there's these communities and my family, and we work so hard and we do so much. And we really try to be part of British Western society, but we're constantly rejected by our political figureheads. And so this is the motivation as to why I make the work and why I feel like it's really important that we should have these conversations. You know, these are the conversations that we should be having right now, about what is going on in our society. Why are we in this position right now? And it was a really wonderful, beautiful series. And we ended up having an exhibition at the local library. Dewey Lewis published the book. I was able to give back the books to the people as a thank you. And that was really important because, like I've said before, without them, I can't make the work that I do. And so, you know, I really felt like my work was going to, I really felt actually You Get Me was going to be my first series that was going to be exhibited. And it actually ended up being my third series. And, you know, Mark Seeley's been an incredible ambassador of my practice. I actually met him 6 years earlier. And Mark really helped network me around the country and talk to all the museums and some amazing people. And you know, then I had this opportunity with Mark to kind of show the work in London. And this was it. You know, this was 9 years of making my work and pushing it around. And what was interesting was that even the Commonality of Strangers series really didn't get the kind of, I would say, the kind of press that I really hoped it would get. And I think that it was because we weren't really ready for that kind of conversation about challenging the politics that are around us. But in 2017, you know, we had Brexit, we had Trump, you know, racism was rife everywhere, you know, and I think people were very shocked about what was going on. So when You Get Me came out, I had to really make a decision. And the decision was this, you know, do I talk the academic speak? Do I talk and say words like male redundancy and throw out government sticks and politics around prison systems and populations in the UK? Or do I be really honest? And I was really honest. And I really talked about how growing up, the racial violence that I suffered, the Paki bashing that I suffered, the fact that we felt so invisible in these spaces, in museum and gallery spaces. You know, my key motivation was to represent us in museum and gallery spaces, to be part of the art historical canon. And the reason why I ended up making portraits that were beautiful, because I wanted to celebrate us as noble, dignified sitters. And so the show opened, I had my first interview at Huck magazine, and that's kind of what I said. And it really rippled. And it went crazy. And what was amazing that, you know, at the opening, we had over 600 people come. In terms of press, I think we hit almost close to 2 million in 2 months. And it was because I think we were ready to have a really honest conversation. And the way I did the hang was that the larger portraits were unglazed, and there were the kind of slightly older men and talking, and then the quotes were really talking about them feeling disenfranchised, hopeless. And then the smaller portraits were of the young boys. And it was really looking at boyhood, but also how we're not a monolith, as we're constantly told. And I glazed them, so they were behind glass. And it was this conversation that, how do we stop this generation from feeling disenfranchised, like the older men? And yeah, it was in a really incredible moment. And I'm really thankful to say that the work itself has now been collected in some amazing collections, and it's also toured across the country, and it's also gone to the States. And thankfully to Mark also, you know, my You Get Me series was published by Michael at Mac. And, you know, one of the things we did in the book was a very personal essay which talked about my motivations, but we also included a lot of quotes in the book, which were the voices of the community. But also at the back of the book, I wanted to use the research that I've been doing over the last 5-6 years of newspaper headlines. And I really wanted to kind of put them at the back of the book so people could really see the propaganda that was happening, you know, and it crystallized the fact that, yeah, we have been really demonized, and our narrative has been totally hijacked, and we've been completely muzzled and voiceless. So that was the You Get Me series kind of high point. I was actually like really exhausted at that point. And, you know, we were still having conversations in the press, and Nigel Farage saying, go back home. And I was like, you know what, I'm going to actually go back home to Pakistan and see and really articulate what it is that my parents ended up leaving. So I did this series called Going Back Home to Where I Came From. And it was a phrase that a lot of kids used to say to me as well when I was growing up. And I really wanted to, in this series, you know, we published the book, and it was with the British Council and Icon Gallery, and, you know, New Art Gallery in Warsaw ended up exhibiting the work, was to kind of pay homage to my mum's stories. She, you know, as we were growing up, she'd always tell me that, you know, how rich and how diverse Pakistan is and Kashmir. You know, she used to talk about the forests and the rivers and the lakes, and I used to say, along with my brothers and sisters, Mom, if Pakistan was so great, if Kashmir was so great, why are we here? You know, why are we struggling? And she'd always say, you're here for a better life. You're here to be educated and to do better than I could. And so when I went back, I really wanted to pay homage to her memories. And so, you know, this is the well that she would have gone to as a little girl to get water. When I made this portrait of this young boy, I was thinking, man, I could have been that young boy running in the river and jumping in the streams instead of running away from the racists. And, you know, I met my great grandma for the first time. I researched traditional mud houses, mitigagars, which I wanted to, you know, pay homage to our humble beginnings. And I really fell in love with the light out there. And I really had this moment of just having fun with photography. You know, the work wasn't as rigid as the kind of three-quarter length formulaic wide landscapes that I was making in my You Get Me an Honest With You series, because that was referencing, you know, popular culture and it was referencing, you know, billboards. But this was all about just tones, textures and light, and I had the most incredible time out there. And, you know, I really fell in love with Kashmir. And I remember on the roof top of my mum's house under the starlit skies, and my cousin was talking about Azad Kashmir, Free Kashmir, and we were eating walnuts from my mum's tree. And, you know, he was just saying, you know, if I want food, I can just get it from the land. There's no such thing as, you know, real capitalism in Kashmir. And I experienced that actually. And I said to him, oh, I really hope that I can have some of this for myself. And when I said that, he said to me, no, this isn't yours, this is mine. Your home's England. And so, you know, it really crystallized conversations that I was having with a lot of my friends and the people I photographed, where it's this narrative that we are a lost generation. We don't really know where we fit. But I think through my work, what I'm trying to say is that we don't have to choose. We can bring everything together. And, you know, part of the exhibition at New Art Exchange, you know, I really wanted to build a traditional mud house. And this was a very, very much, again, a collaboration with the community. We had four different communities come over the space of 2 weeks, and they helped build this house. We had elders, Pakistani, there was a Pakistani women's group who came, and they literally lined the house with clay. And we had this beautiful sound piece of birds playing in the gallery. And we ended up kind of decorating the space on the inside. So for me, it's really important that we can, that through my practice, that we can create this kind of community collaboration. So this is kind of the work that I've been making, and I've had this incredible opportunity with Chris Boot, who was former director of Aperture. And I've just come back from a 6-week trip in Toronto and also New York City. And, you know, the idea is to really look at the American Muslim experience in contrast to going on here in Britain. So this is a little bit of an exclusive in terms of showing you the portraits that I've been making out there. And what's incredible, I feel, is that the conversation in North America is like 20 years ahead. And the youth there have this incredible hope and this aspiration to really make a difference, to really change the way that we are perceived. And I was so welcomed. I mean, in the 6 weeks that I was there, I ended up making 75. I worked incredibly hard, but the level of engagement and the willingness to be part of a different conversation was something I just haven't experienced in the UK. And there's a gentleness there that isn't here in the UK. And I think that it's down to the kind of political violence and the violence that the community really suffered in this country. And it's so diverse in America. You know, I met people from, you know, Palestine. I met people from all over Africa. I met people from Iraq, Yemen. It was just such an amazing series. And so this is part of the New York City work. And, you know, these are the four portraits that I'm able to kind of share with you. And yeah, I'm excited. This is the kind of start of a bigger series that I'm trying to do in America. And what's really interesting is that every time I finished making a portrait of someone, they said, thank you so much for allowing us to have a voice and an opportunity to really talk about our complexities. So I feel really privileged and really humble that I have the opportunity to do that in the US, but also the crazy thing that actually, you know, no one else is doing this. No one else is really making this work to try and create this visual narrative of Muslims globally and celebrate them as beautiful fine art portraiture. So yeah, this is me. So I want to thank you very much for listening to my talk, and I welcome any questions.
Hi, Mahtab. Thank you so much for that. That was really fascinating. Sorry, am I on camera now? That was really fascinating and so rich, and I feel like you've tackled a lot of questions that I was going to pose. So I didn't introduce myself. My name is Luisa Ulyett, and I'm curator of talks and events at the Photographers Gallery. Thanks everyone for joining us. We're about to open it up to questions from you. So do send them through the chat box here. I might just start us off with a question of my own. I do feel like you've answered a lot of my questions, Mahtab, but you focused a lot on the sitter. And I know that's something that you view as a collaboration. It's something that both people have creative hands in making the final image. But I wondered a little bit about the backdrops to some of the images and also how it's been the subject of some of your work, like Muslim ghettos, for instance, mm-hmm. and how you determine the place with the sitter, but also in that instance, how the place becomes the subject.
Yeah, sure. So, you know, I really see the street as my studio. And one of the things I try and do with my backdrops is really limit the color palette. Now I could, you know, put them in areas which look very impoverished and, you know, this kind of really perpetuating that narrative of this ghettoization of these communities. And I didn't want to do that. I think I started doing that with my work very early on. And I realized that this is just jarring. This is kind of feeding the certain stereotypes. So when I meet someone, I walk with them and we end up just walking the streets. And as I'm talking to them, my eyes are everywhere. And I'm trying to find the backdrop, the right space to be able to celebrate their brown skin. The most important thing for me is how do I celebrate their brown skin in the frame? And that's why the backdrops can be quite muted or limited or brick walls or just greenery they're in corners. If I put them in corners, it's really to kind of celebrate Irvin Penn's work in the studio a little bit. This is kind of my little moment and that's it. And the reason why the Muslim Ghetto series is very separate from any of the other work that I put together is because I don't want to mix those things up. Because very early on, or actually not even early on, but close to be publishing the book with Michael, we had those images in the book. And I remember flicking through one of the drafts and I was like, this is making me feel sorry for this community. Like, I don't want to do that. So I said to Michael, I think we've got to get rid of this stuff. This is pushing it into a narrative that I don't want to put it in. You know, Michael and I sat down and he just thought about it for a minute. He's like, yeah, you made the right decision. And so we moved it on. And the Muslim Ghetto series is going to form another body of work that I'm making with Icon Gallery and Photo Works in the next year or two, which would be about the illegal CCTV that was placed in Birmingham. So that's going to have its moment in its own right. But for me, it's all about trying to find beautiful backdrops. And so then the sitter becomes the celebrated subject, really.
Yeah, no, that reads like that too. I suppose that I can see how it's viewed in a way that distinguishes itself from the portraits that you do. We do have some questions coming in now. I'll start with Rahab Alana, one of our contributors for the subsequent days. She thanks you for the brilliant presentation. If you have a gauge on it, could you talk about the reception of this work in Pakistan and even Kashmir? So that might be, I guess, your home series.
Oh, and actually the you know, My You Get Me series and also the Honest With You series, I had a wonderful opportunity to be part of the Lahore Biennale. And, you know, I was exhibiting with Aisha Khalid. She turned her home, her first home, into a gallery. And I remember, I mean, it was such a moment. I remember one lady who I was hanging out with, her name's Shanaz, and she walked into the space that I was exhibiting, and her face was like rabbit in the headlights. I saw, and her, it was, and I couldn't, I will always remember her reaction, because she saw herself reflected on the walls, but she realized that this community wasn't Pakistani, they were British. And there was this real distinct difference. And so that's, and that reaffirmed what I've always been saying, which is that we are British, we are British, we're just not British or English in the way that maybe British society wants us to be. And so the reception has been really fascinating in that sense. And yeah, my mom, when she goes back to Pakistan, she takes my books and she shares them with family. And of course, everyone's really fascinated about, you know, the evolution of Pakistani culture or Muslim culture in Britain.
Mm. No, and I think it also speaks to what you cited earlier about some shared beliefs and aspirations that exist across a lot of your sitters, and thinking about what you said now about the people you encountered in North America, not versus here, but I suppose just in contrast, but there's something about those shared aspirations that unites people despite geographical distance. Let's see, thank you for that. There's another question around, I guess it's your plan really, around Muslims in the UK. Is there a plan to embrace the multi-ethnic dimension of Muslims in the UK at some point? So I guess, is that bringing, maybe a question of bringing everything into project or an exhibition?
I'd probably say that question is more about looking at, you know, not just Pakistanis, Bangladeshis, or, you know, the South Asian experience, but perhaps people from, you know, the continent of Africa. So yeah, there is plans to build those bodies of work. And I'm definitely doing that in the US. So in the US, it's very much open. It's about the Muslim experience. But yeah, this is like, you know, I'm still young. I'm only 40. So, you know, I've got plenty of time to kind of be building this work. And as you can tell, that a lot of my work takes a long time to research, and not only research, but to position. We all know museums and galleries are heavily booked in advance, and it's about waiting for key time. So I'm constantly working on several projects, waiting for the right time to be able to publish and exhibit. So yeah, I'm not limiting looking at one particular demographic.
Yeah, and I think also the durational element of your research shows the care and rigor that you bring to it. We have a question though about some practical components around how you develop. So this is from Claire Caroline. Thank you, Claire. How do you develop the pose and gestures with the sitter? To what degree are you directing the sitter, or they're citing specifically the picture of Pharaoh where you said you wanted to hold a cricket bat. So how much, I guess it's about your collaboration, do you?
Yeah, so that there, I basically carried I carried the cricket bat with me, and I borrowed it from a friend of mine. And so I was walking around London with it. But, you know, when my work comes to the kind of end of a series, I basically start to look at where the holes are. And I talk about this idea of building a really wide color palette. And then I edit and paint in the studio, and then I realize what's missing. So then I start to kind of really direct and imagine the kind of portraits that I want to make. And that's when my intervention really comes into play. It's like, well, what is missing? What do I need in this series? And I'm very meticulous about it. I will break down a sequence of like, right, I've got this. And then it's about building on it. But in terms of how do I make my portraits? Yeah, I direct. I very much direct. And it's about getting the sitter at ease, because I want them to feel like they can really own their portrait and really celebrate their own representation. And, you know, a lot of the sitters in the US were like, oh, thank God you're really good at directing. I really hate being in front of the camera. And I kept saying to them, I got you. And because they kept saying to me, I got you. And so I'm like, yeah, I'm going to make sure that it's 10 out of 10 when we walk away from each other. And if it's not, I'm going to come back to you. So with time, with the luxury of wanting to build legacy projects over a long period, I have the luxury of going back to them and meeting them again and remaking. And because I don't want to rush this, because once it's out and once you really put this big, powerful visual culture out, you want to make sure it's going to really hit back at the propaganda. And so I try my best to give myself as much time as possible in my work.
That makes sense. I mean, it can be a very vulnerable experience for the sitter, but also the work that you're trying to do that dispels and challenges really dominant, problematic, and limiting narratives.
Mm, totally.
There's a question here from Graham Harrison. Your subjects in America thanked you for allowing them to talk about their complexities. So still talking about the sitter relationship. Do you feel that still photography is capable of conveying such complexities? Or might you think of using more words or even film in your work?
Yeah, so we're doing everything now. So with Chris, I'm really excited to say that I've got a show with Stephen Borger Gallery in Toronto, and we're having a few days before we're having an online discussion, and where I'm inviting the sitters to come and talk. And we're going to have this really wonderful exchange. And so the interviews that I conduct with everyone will be starting to do online, almost like a podcast. And it is really trying to, you know, use the power of social media, use all the tools that we can use today to be able to kind of have the conversation. And it's the conversation that's the most important thing. Yes, the portraits are beautiful and they elevate and they're fine art and all those things, but actually what I really want to do is elevate the next level, which is to make the sitters come alive. And you know, I've interviewed everyone, we've transcribed all the interviews, they will be in the book. I'm thinking about working with a sound artist to create audio pieces in the museum and gallery spaces. So there's all these things, but I think ultimately portraiture is just really, really powerful. It can speak without words. And you know, that's what I love about portraiture. It has this unspoken conversation. So regardless of the fact that, you know, not all the time you're going to read the quotes and have their voices, just to be able to see the Muslim visual culture, like how diverse this community is, that's powerful in its own right. You know, some of the portraits I made in the US, I'm like, man, they don't even look Muslim, and that's what really excites me, you know. So that's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah, I remember something that you said to me when we spoke last week, where you said that photography is, I'm reading your quote because I wrote it down, photography is the most important discipline to have these societal conversations.
Totally, because we're so, as a society, we are so trained and we know how to read an image. And, you know, photography is the most powerful medium. And I think, and the reason why is because we're all so seduced by it. I mean, look, everyone takes images, everyone makes images, everyone consumes them. So I'm going to try and celebrate the fact that everyone feels like they're a photographer and everyone feels like they can have a comment on images and visual culture. So yeah, and photography is the medium that demonized us. And even if you look at archival work, you know, there's a few archives that I'm working on which basically demonized us back in the Hindustan regions and times. And I really feel like that's when the degrading terminology really came about with our communities. So yeah, the colonial apparatus of photography is something that I want to challenge too. So it's about fighting back in every element.
I'm just noticing the time. I'm really sorry. We won't be able to get to every question here today. I might just ask one final one from those that were submitted, and then we'll move to closing remarks. But thank you, everyone, for your comments. This question brings us back to how we started the conversation today, which was looking at institutions, organizations, and the wider sector of photography. So how difficult was it for you to gain access to photography art organizations in the UK? And have you experienced overt or indirect racism in these places?
It was difficult. Don't get me wrong. If you if you look at the spaces that really gave me those opportunities, there were spaces like New Art Exchange, like Autograph, and the spaces that really focused on giving Black and South Asian voices artists opportunities. And the thing is, you know, I've worked in museum and galleries for 8 years before I jumped ship and became an artist. And the people who work in these spaces are my friends. And you know, there was moments where I was very disheartened by some conversations that were taking place between you know, the curators and people that I really felt like we could challenge these narratives. But the reality is that, you know, sometimes, you know, it's hard. Like, it's not an easy, and I don't think it's, you know, I get this conversation a lot. Is the art industry racist? No, it's not. Is it difficult to get into these spaces? Of course it is. It's difficult for everyone. But what I wanted to do as an artist was to say, you know what, if I can put working class brown people on museum and gallery walls, and if I can position them as fine art portraiture, and if I can get them collected in amazing collections like the Government Art Collection, like the National Portrait Gallery in Scotland, you know, there's hope. So, you know, let's not say that, you know, the art world is racist. Let's just keep pushing gently and with love, and let's have a really open conversation. And it takes time. Real change takes time, and I'm not going anywhere. So, you know, I hope all the other artists aren't going to be deterred either, really.
Thanks. That's very heartening, especially as someone who's also a fan of museums and galleries. But it's not as though we're not aware of how fraught they can be with their own problems and how they get.
And that's the complexity, isn't it, really? But, you know, we're all here trying to make a difference.
Yeah, and I think especially with your work, it starts with changing what's on the walls and allowing these stories and those who are visiting to see their lives and experiences reflected and to feel that connection.
Yeah, and that was the conversation that I had at the, you know, Autograph, you know, when the show opened. Everyone was saying, I never thought these two worlds would come together. And for me, that was enough. I was like, great, I've done my job. You know, because that's what I wanted. I wanted my two worlds to come together. You know, I really love museum and gallery spaces, and I know the power of those walls. And I just really, you know, I wanted that to come together, and it did. And so it was a great moment.
Thank you. That's a really nice thought to end on. And I hope that's something, or that's a view and experience that are shared by many here. And I'm sure we're all really hopeful and ambitious of what the future has, both for your practice, but also what museums, galleries, organizations, collectives, cooperatives, what they can bring. I'm going to have to wrap things up today, but Mahtab, that was really such a wonderful presentation. It was really great to also get a sense of where you're going with the work in North America and how you're going to kind of pick up some other threads that you've been working on. So thank you for that. And thank you all for joining us today. It's been such a rich and fascinating day of discussions and debates as we looked at the formation of photography over the last 50 years as a practice, as a sector, and as a site for critical debate. Thank you to all our speakers, Shara Mavlin, Anne McNeil, David Bate, Tawis Damani, David Dudney, Annabella Pollan, and this afternoon with Karen Shepherdson, Juliet Hacking, and Anne Lyden. I hope I haven't forgotten anyone. To our collaborators, of course, at Paul Mellon Center, Mark Hallett, Sarah Turner, Shauna Blanchfield, Dana Convey, and to my colleagues at the Photographers Gallery. Thank you. And lastly, and importantly, thank you all for joining us for this momentous partnership between Paul Mellon Center and the Photographers Gallery. We will pick things up next week, starting again on Wednesday, the 1st of December, when we look at materiality and process and printed material, like the magazine and photo publications. And more information is available on both our website, at the Photographers Gallery's website, and Paul Mellon Center's. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day, and thank you again so much, Mahtab. It was really lovely to have you here.
A real pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks, everyone. Right. And
bye.